Should my life be torn from me? Every worldly pleasure, when all I possess is grief, God be then my treasure, and be my vision in the night, be my hope and refuge, till my face is turned to sight, Lord, my heart will praise you. Oh, my soul, put your hope in God, my help, my rock, I will praise him. Sing, oh, sing through the raging storm, you're still my God, my salvation.
Good morning, church family. Ooh, has everybody got the flu, have they? Because not many people here. That time of year, hey? We had Boys Brigade cancelled on Friday because leaders were sick. We don't have any Sunshine Corner today because our leaders are sick. It's people are a bit thin on the ground at the moment, but that's okay. We're here to worship, so that's good. Please stand and sing with us. We'll start with Amazing Grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace I changed our God. shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be.
Father, we come here today to worship you, praise you, and glorify your name. We pray that the Holy Spirit will be moving among us today as we do that. And Lord, we pray for our brothers and sisters who are sick and not with us today. We pray that they will know your grace and your comfort today as well. And we pray these things in the name of Lord Jesus. Amen.
Daily, daily I surrender. Grace for today is all that I need. Surprised by your mercy, it's new every morning. Awaken my soul to sing. Oh, awaken my soul to sing. I will trust where you lead. I will trust when I can't see. Morning by morning, great is your faithfulness to me. Breath by breath overtake. Bright hope for tomorrow. Awaken my soul to sing. Oh, awaken my soul to sing. I will trust where you lead. I will trust when I. With all
Well, please take a seat. I'll quickly run through our announcements. So, as I mentioned earlier, there's no Sunshine Corner today because we don't have enough leaders because everybody's sick. But Junior Church is still on, so I'll send you guys out in a little while. There'll be a bush barbecue next Saturday, so keep an eye out in the newsletter for more information about that. And there will also be a prayer meeting next Sunday. Once again, keep an eye out on the newsletter and some announcements next Sunday with the specifics about that. And if you would like to be added to our database so that you do get our newsletter, please have a chat to Tim and make sure that your email address and phone number are current in there so you can get copies of those each week. And Sarah has an announcement.
Morning, everyone. I just want to give a really quick update on IDAT. A couple of weeks ago, we pitched to at the members' meeting that the youth conference is coming up in the beginning of August for in Tonge for the youth. It's not just for the town of the village of Tonge. What they do is they outreach to all the villages around and they try to bring as many youth representatives into the town to come to this conference. So they had it on their heart to host another one this year. And so we put it out to our church and to the church and on our Facebook page as well. And we'd just like to give an update that we have reached the goal and more from what they were budgeted. So the team had budgeted $4,900 US, which is about 6,900 Australian. And we have received $7,200.75. So praise God that in just a very short amount of time, the funds have come through and now they are hitting the ground running, trying to get the supplies in and get the word out to get the youth in. So please commit this time to prayer and the team in the planning process and that that the youth will come as abundantly as they did last year. Just one more thing that we would like to commit to prayer as well. Ben had a nice conversation with Susie yesterday, touching base on all things IDAT, and she has requested that I come over in October as they're hosting another cataract team for a couple of weeks. So she is asking us to commit this time to prayer to see if that's what God wants. And so we're going home this afternoon, crunching some numbers to see if it's feasible. But we would really appreciate your prayer in God's guidance in that, as it would be potentially my first time stepping out. Ben's a bit nervous about the idea of me going on my own. So if it can work out, we'd love your prayer and support on that. So thank you very much.
So long as you don't stay gone so long. We have a kids video, so if the kids want to come and sit at the front and watch the video, seeing as we have no Sunshine Corner, we've put a kids video in.
Before Jesus returned to heaven, he told his followers that the Holy Spirit would give them power to share the gospel in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. That is exactly what happened. The early church grew, spreading out in different cities as more and more people heard the gospel and trusted in Jesus. The believers met together and leaders taught them about God and about how Christians should live. Paul wrote letters to some of the leaders in the church. Two of these leaders were Timothy and Titus. Timothy was Paul's friend. He had traveled with Paul and helped him. Now Timothy was a leader at the church in Ephesus. In his letter to Timothy, Paul reminded him not to let anyone look down on him because he was young. Paul said, "Be an example of what a believer says and does." Timothy could show people how to live how to love, and how to trust God. Paul also taught Timothy to read the scriptures to the believers in the church. He taught him to be patient and to correct people when they do wrong things. Timothy could encourage believers by teaching them what is right. Timothy could teach God's word and always be ready to share the gospel. Being a leader in the church is not easy. Paul told Timothy that God had chosen him to lead. Paul wrote, "Do not be afraid to suffer for the Lord." Titus was a Gentile believer and leader. He was also a friend of Paul's. Titus had traveled with Paul and was on the island of Crete to help train more church leaders. When Paul wrote to Titus, he explained why believers should live in a way that pleases God. Paul explained that God is gracious to sinners. God gave us what we do not deserve when he provided the way for people to be saved from sin. Because of this, we want to do what is right. We want to live in ways that please God. Jesus died on the cross to rescue us from sin and death, and we want to do what is good because he loves us. We know that one day, Jesus will come again. Paul wrote to guide Timothy and Titus and to help all church leaders know how to lead God's people. Church leaders help believers know what is true, and they serve the church by following the example of Jesus, who served us by dying on the cross for our sins.
Well, thanks, kiddies. There are some colouring in sheets and some pencils up the back if you'd like to go grab some. Can I please ask our stewards to take up the offering before we start our next song? Please stand and sing with us. In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. To reveal the kingdom coming, and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. For even in your suffering,
you saw to the other side. Knowing this was our salvation, Jesus, for your sake you died. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. And the morning that you rose, all of heaven held its breath, till that stone was moved for good, and the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored. And the Church of Christ was born, and the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Praise the
Church, you guys can head out now.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. the joy of thy salvation and renew a right spirit within me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation and renew a right spirit within me. And renew a right spirit within me.
Please take a seat. I'd like to welcome Ross to share our Bible reading.
Morning, church. Today's Bible reading is from the book of Ephesians, chapter 1, verses 1 to 10. From Paul, by God's will, an apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ, to God's people living in Ephesus, that is, those who are trusting in the Messiah Jesus. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus himself. Praise be to God, Father of our Lord Jesus, the Messiah who lived, who in the Messiah has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in heaven. In him he chose us in love before the creation of the universe to be holy and without defect in his presence. He determined in advance that through Jesus we would be his sons and daughters in keeping with his pleasure and purpose, so that we would bring him praise along with the glory of the grace he gave us through the Beloved One. In union with him, through the shedding of his blood, we are set free. Our sins are forgiven. This accords with the wealth of the grace he has lavished on us. In all his wisdom and insight, he has made known to us of his secret plan, which by his own will he designed beforehand in connection with the Messiah, and will put into effect when the time is ripe. His plan to place everything in heaven and on earth under the headship of Jesus Christ himself. Also in union, that's the end of today's reading. Thank you.
And thank you, Christy, and wonderful to have you with us this morning. Just a note that there is a team from William Baptist out at Lake Nash, yesterday and this morning as well, and that's being led by Graham Circum, and they're looking at the topic of the creation of godly families. So a good number of our Indigenous brothers and sisters I know have travelled to Lake Nash this weekend as well to be with that community as well. Let me pray. Father, we thank you for your holy, inerrant and life-giving word. We thank you that you've chosen us to be holy and blameless in your sight. Make us worthy of that calling. Amen. Well, previously, if you might remember last week in verse 3, Paul had spoken about the incredible spiritual blessings that we have, spiritual blessings that reside in heavenly places. And then he joins that sentence with this next one, with a conjunction. Your translation will say something like even as, or for, or according, to indicate that the spiritual blessings are those which Paul is now about to talk about. And what does Paul immediately talk about? Well, he talks about how our faith originates, or the cause of our regeneration. Even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace, with which he's blessed us in the Beloved. Well, you may be aware that conversations in election and predestination are often the cause of spirited debate. Have you been in one of those conversations? In fact, this was the first marked difference between Baptists. In the 17th century, within the space of 30 years, two distinct groups of Baptists arose in England. The first were the General Baptists, who took a free will perspective in regard to salvation. These first English Baptists, under the leadership of a man named John Smith, a very original name, John Smith and Thomas Ellis, fled to escape the persecution of the State Church of England. And they arrived in Amsterdam, where they were heavily influenced by the Anabaptists. And the Anabaptists emphasized human responsibility in salvation. That is, in and of ourselves, we have the capacity to respond to the message of the gospel. Now, John Smith and Thomas Ellis didn't remain in Amsterdam. They saw the need to return to England, even at the risk of persecution, for the sake of the gospel, and so returned to England in 1611, after which a number of General Baptist churches grew. The general in the name General Baptist refers to an understanding of the atonement or the work of Christ as unlimited atonement. That is that the benefits of Christ's death and resurrection are available to everyone without exception. Now, these General Baptists understood that election referred to Christ, that Christ was the elect one, and so in their Orthodox Creed of the General Baptists published in 1679, they reflect this position. Now, predestination unto life is the everlasting purpose of God, whereby the foundation of the world was laid. He hath constantly decreed in the council secret to us to deliver from curse and damnation those whose he has chosen in Christ, and bring them to everlasting salvation as vessels made to honour through Jesus Christ, whom he elected before the foundation of the world, and is called, that's Christ, is called God's elect, in whom his soul delights. Or in other words, the Father has elected the Son, Christ, and we gain salvation as we put our faith in Jesus, the elect one. Now, at the same time, there were other nonconformists in England who didn't go to Amsterdam, those who weren't influenced by the Anabaptists and the free will understanding of salvation that they had, who were convinced of Baptist principles but held to the theology of salvation that was similar to the Reformers, that of Luther, that of John Calvin, that of Ulrich Zwingli, who held in some form of a theology not of free will but of the bondage of the will. And so these Reformers emphasized the sovereignty of God in salvation, that in and of ourselves, we don't have the capacity to respond to the good news, and so we need the Holy Spirit to bring us to life, to grant us the gifts of faith and repentance. And these Baptists were called particular Baptists, and the particular referred to their understanding that the work of Christ on the cross in the atonement was applied to the elect. You might have heard this as limited atonement. And the first particular Baptist church was formed in a very English place called Wapping in England, 1633. And like the General Baptists, they would also write their beliefs in a confession of faith. And you can read their confession in the 1689 London Baptist Confession of Faith, which has many similarities to the Westminster Confession of Faith. And under chapter 3, paragraph 3, you can read of God's sovereign decree, how they understood this understanding of election. By the decree of God, for the manifestation of his glory, some men and angels are predestined or foreordained to eternal life through Jesus Christ, to the praise of his glorious grace, others being left to act in their sin, to their just condemnation, to the praise of his glorious justice. And so you can see the difference in the confessions between these Baptists. The General Baptists understood that Christ was the elect one, and we are saved as we exercise our will and place it in Christ. And the particular Baptists understood those terms that relate to election, chosen, predestination, as referring to individuals. The Father elects individuals. Now, I bring this up simply because I understand that within this doctrine, when we talk about election, there's a number of perspectives, largely two perspectives. One that emphasizes free will, and the other that emphasizes God's sovereignty. And in regards to Baptist churches, you will find that there are free will Baptist churches, Reformed Baptist churches. And then there are Baptist churches that, while acknowledging that these truths are important, that a person's would still say that a person's faith is not ultimately contingent on their understanding of predestination, and endeavour to be gracious to each other in spite of differences on this matter. We talk about these things, we debate about these things, but we don't divide over these things as best we can. Now, that being said, it's hard for me as a pastor not to have a conviction on this matter. And you'll quickly see that my conviction falls with the particular Baptists on this matter, that God has chosen a people for himself for his glory. And if you see things a bit differently to me, then perhaps I can persuade you of some of the things that I see in the passage this morning. But if not, I'll continue to be gracious to you, and perhaps you'll be gracious to me and engage in spirited debate. Well, Paul is eager to tell us about the spiritual blessings that we have in Christ. And immediately he tells us that we are chosen in Christ. A good place to start will be to consider the question, how is it that any of us are enjoying the spiritual blessings in Jesus? Now, many people would answer that and say, well, I have repented of my sin. I've put my faith in Jesus. But notice where Paul begins here. He doesn't begin with faith and repentance or a decision for Christ. That, of course, is involved. But that's not where Paul starts. And many would say that all this is possible because of what Christ did on the cross when he came in the world, his life, his death, his resurrection, his ascension. That's the source of our spiritual blessings. But again, Paul doesn't even begin with Christ's work on our behalf. Notice that Paul doesn't begin with anything that occurred within time or in our world. When Paul talks about our salvation, where does he go to? Well, he goes right back into eternity before the foundation of the world and begins with what has been done by God the Father. This is where all of our theology must begin, with what has been accomplished, not by ourselves, but by God. This is what the Bible is, a book that tells us what God has done for us. It's a book of the revelation of His grace towards sinful men and women, and this is the primary thread that runs through all of Scripture. What God has done, what God has promised to do, and what He is doing, and what He will do. And this is what Paul is doing here. Paul's not relying on his own wisdom. No human wisdom could come up with what Paul writes here. Would never arrive at something even close to the gospel. Rather, Paul is writing what God has revealed to him. And the teaching is that those who enjoy these spiritual blessings do so because they have been chosen by God. And Paul tells us in verse 4, we are chosen in Him before the foundation of the world. And so Paul tells us, salvation does not ultimately begin with you and your decision. Rather, the inception of your salvation can be traced back before time even began and before the material world was created. Your salvation is not an accident. Your salvation came about not because you and not others were fortunate enough to hear the gospel. Rather, it was all planned by God and according to His purposes. And it needed to be planned. By nature of the fall, we are rebels against God. We are in spiritual chains. Having been enticed by the evil one to sin, we now find ourselves under the wrath of God. And we think, well, how do we get out of that situation? And I would argue Paul is telling us here is that God has chosen us to be delivered from wrath to salvation. Well, as I mentioned, and as you know, there are different perspectives on God's work in election. And I'll touch briefly on two of them. A first perspective is that Christians, those who enjoy the blessings of God, were chosen by God before the foundation of the world because God, in His perfect foreknowledge, saw people who would exercise faith in Him. And by doing so, distinguished themselves from people who do not exercise faith. Now, that will sound like a reasonable position, but I'd like to raise two objections against it. First, in that perspective, this emphasis remains not on the choice of God, but on the choice of the individual. In that situation, people are saved based on their election of themselves. And second, I believe this position ignores that Scripture says about the condition of the unregenerate individual. Consider this question, how far did the human race fall when Adam plunged us into rebellion? Did we fall upwards towards God? Did we fall part way but not the whole way? Are we affected by sin but nevertheless possess in ourselves the ability to turn from sin and believe the gospel message? Or has sin left us completely hopeless? And that's how I understand how sin has left us. Consider a few verses here. Genesis 6, verse 5. The Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. So I don't think that describes humankind as falling upwards. In the next chapter of Ephesians, chapter 2, verse 1, Paul tells us that previously we were dead in our trespasses and our sins, dead. And Paul says in Romans chapter 3, no one understands God, no one seeks for God. So no one's looking for God. And the picture that this gives us is that we cannot respond. We've fallen in such a way that we are incapable of any move back to God unless God reaches down and by His Spirit breathes new life into us, into our stone-cold dead hearts, spiritual hearts, so that we can respond. What good could God possibly foresee in hearts that are dead in transgression and sin and inclined only towards evil? I'd say that there's no faith to foresee in us. Now, a second perspective of election is that we are too hopelessly lost in our sin and our rebellion to ever want to choose God's spiritual blessings for ourselves. And so God in His mercy chose us and then made that choice effectual, meaning that when God calls us, He breathes new life into us so that we can respond to Him. He made our salvation possible by sending Christ to die for our sin, and then He made us capable of responding to the call of the gospel by sending His Holy Spirit. And we do read in Scripture that both faith and repentance are gifts given by God, a work of the Holy Spirit. Martin Lloyd-Jones describes it this way: we are chosen by God simply as the result of His own good pleasure, or, to use scriptural phraseology, according to the good pleasure of His will, and entirely apart from anything we've ever done or said or thought. Indeed, it goes further and says that we are chosen by God out of the good pleasure of His own will, in spite of ourselves, in spite of the fact that we were enemies, aliens, and even haters of God. And I believe this is what Paul is communicating when he says that we are chosen in Him. Words like chosen and predestination and election are words in Scripture, and so as much as sometimes we'd like to ignore them, we can't. And they are definitely communicating weighty and difficult truths that are sometimes hard to understand. But they go back and communicate truths that extend back to the secret counsels of God in eternity past. There are some observations that we can make when we consider a phrase like chosen in Him or predestined for adoption. The first is that, at least here in Ephesians, Paul speaks about these matters as a statement of fact, a matter of fact, and a point not to raise argument in the church, but a point to cause us to praise and glorify God. Paul's intention isn't to bring us to argue about these matters. Second, the chapter that Paul does provide a lengthy discussion on the matter of election, he reprimands us when we begin to argue that we don't understand this teaching. You might know that from Romans 9. In Romans 9, verse 18, Paul speaks of God's purpose in election, and then he summarizes this teaching by saying in verse 18, "So then, this is God has mercy on whomever He wills, and God hardens whomever He wills." And at that point, we want to shout at Paul and say, "Well, that's not fair. That's unjust that you would treat one person with mercy and another you would harden." And Paul anticipates these objections, and so he says, in way of reminding us not to question God, "You will say to me then, why does He still find fault? For who can resist His will? But who are you, O man, to answer back to God? Will what is molded say to its molder, why have you made me like this? Has the potter no right over the clay to make out of the same lump one vessel for honorable use and another for dishonorable use? What if God, desiring to show His wrath and to make known His power, has endured with much patience vessels of wrath prepared for destruction, in order to make known the riches of His glory for vessels of mercy, which He's prepared beforehand for glory?" And so Paul doesn't give a lengthy discussion to explain God's choice. He simply says that God is free to act this way. And we must realize who God is, the sovereign ruler over all things. He doesn't need to answer to you or me or to anyone. And Paul tells us that our relationship to this God is one of a lump of clay to a potter. And that before we put our objections forth and our failures to understand the doctrine of election, we need to know that our finite minds are incapable of understanding the purposes of God and the pleasures of God. We, of course, as a human race at the beginning, didn't listen to God. We listened to the evil one. And we were enticed to sin. We brought ourselves to ruin rather than listening to God and remain in obedience. We think, well, who are we to answer back to God when we listen to the evil one and we're enticed by him? Who are we to understand the fine, infinite mind of God? And third, God's freedom is consistent with the entirety of Scripture. Consider the Old Testament, his choice of Abraham. Abraham was an idol-worshipping pagan before God called him to be the father of a nation. Consider similar statements in the New Testament and words from Jesus. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him. That's Jesus. John 15, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit. Consider the words of Jesus' high priestly prayer in John 17. I've manifested your name to the people whom you gave me out of the world. And Paul uses this kind of language all through his letters as well. One particularly helpful passage is in chapter 2 of Ephesians, where we said that Paul tells us that we were dead in our trespasses and sin. But then in the next verse, verse 4 and 5, see who takes the initiative to bring us out of that state of deadness. Is it us or is it God? Well, Paul says, but God. There's the divine initiative, but God, being rich in mercy because of the great love which he has loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, it was God who made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. Well, I said at the start that Paul begins Ephesians by telling us about the spiritual blessings that we have in the heavenly places. And he begins by talking about the origins of our faith. And what does Paul tell us? Well, I would say that our faith originates in God's choice and God's intervention in our life. Now, I must admit that most of us, when we first hear this doctrine explained this way, very much dislike it. I remember the first time that someone explained the doctrine of election to me this way. I thought, you're out of your mind. I thought, God didn't make that decision. I made that decision. And I disliked it a lot because I hadn't realized the extent and the damage of sin to my life. But this doctrine revealed to me that the true nature and consequences of my sin. My sin had put me in a position to which I was utterly hopeless, totally incapable of doing anything useful in matters of salvation. As Paul says, I was spiritually dead. But this is what sin has done to us. It has made us strangers to God. And in our sin, without the intervention of the Holy Spirit, not only do we not choose God, but we continue to choose our sin. And we do so until that moment that the Spirit makes us alive. If you have a faith in Christ, I invite you to ask the question, why is it that I have faith in Christ? Why is it that you have faith in Christ? Why do you have a faith and somebody else you know doesn't have a faith? Perhaps it's somebody in your own family, a brother or sister who heard the message of the gospel, who sat in a church service week after week with you, who heard the good news, but you have a faith and they don't. Do you believe it's because you were more disposed to understanding the gospel than they were? Was it because that you were more spiritual or were you more moral? When you stand before God, how will you answer that question? Well, I don't think you'll answer by saying that you were more spiritual or more moral or more attuned to the gospel. I believe that you will say, only because of your grace. That's all we can answer. Only because of your grace in this matter, Lord. Well, there are a number of objections that come when the topic of election is discussed this way. And so let me quickly address some objections. The first, you might say, well, this is arbitrary. On what basis does God have to make, as Paul says, one vessel for honorable use and another for dishonorable use? I certainly had this question. It made no sense. What's the basis of God's decision? Why should God have loved Jacob but hated Esau, as we read in Romans 9? But even though we don't understand the reason completely, it doesn't mean that God doesn't have a reason. Paul gives us the answer in our passage in verse 6. to the praise of his glorious grace. That is, God would have been absolutely free and just to choose absolutely no one. But instead, he chose a people for himself so that he would be glorified. And from God's perspective, the perspective that matters, election certainly does have a purpose, that he is glorified. Again, we might think, why doesn't God choose only one person? Why does he choose a great multitude, as we read in the Revelation? Why doesn't he choose everyone? And the Lord doesn't answer those questions for us, but it's far from saying that he has no reasons. The Lord is full of reasons unknown to us. In fact, the psalmist writes in Psalm 115, "Our God is in the heavens. He does all that he pleases." And we can say that God has a purpose and takes pleasure in his work of election. The second objection is that this perspective of election is unjust. It is unjust for God to choose one rather than the other. All should be given a chance. Adam was given a chance, a will to choose, and he squandered it. And if you were in that position, you would have squandered it as well. In Romans 9, when Paul speaks about election, he says of God, "Jacob I loved, but Esau I hated." And when we read that, what should grab our attention is not "Esau I hated," not those words. We should acknowledge that that should be us, that Esau's fate, that God's contempt for Esau should be the way that God sees us, that my sin brings me, should bring me into the same position as well, that I have shown the greatest contempt for God, the highest disregard for God. Why should I deserve a favorable relationship with my Creator after how I have treated him? But what should grab our attention is what God says of Jacob. God loves Jacob. We should think that God, to love anyone, is incredible. Justice is what Esau received. Justice is what we all receive, or should receive. But God's work in election is not justice. Election is grace. And grace cannot be demanded to say to God, "You owe me this. I want this. Give it to me." No, we can't say that. It's given by a gift, as a gift, by the Creator. Now, the third objection to this perspective of election is that it undermines evangelism. In fact, this is what William Carey, I've mentioned him a few times, the Baptist missionary to India, encountered. Carey himself was a particular Baptist. He understood the doctrine of election this way, and he believed in the necessity of God's sovereignty in election. But when he approached the Baptist Association, they retorted, "Well, when God pleases to convert the heathen, he'll do it without consulting you or me." So these men in the association were what's often called hyper-Calvinists. They didn't believe that God uses means in salvation, that if God was to convert someone, he would do so without your or mine help. And what the association desired, well, as I said, is that God doesn't use means in salvation. The ordinary means, as we know, are the proclamation of the gospel and the sending of the Holy Spirit into people's hearts to bring life. We hear the good news. You are hopeless in your sin, condemned to judgment. Christ has died for sin. Repent and believe. And as that message is proclaimed, it's my hope, and I hope your hope as well, that as you tell that message to others, that the Spirit would be at work granting the gifts of faith and repentance. So there's no contradiction here. God has not only ordained that he would have a people for himself, but he's also ordained the means by which he would save them, his word and the preaching of the word. Well, when you come to a puzzling or difficult passage in history, it's also good to consult how those in history understood a certain topic as well. And you'll find this perspective of election in men like Augustine. You'll find it in the Reformers, Martin Luther. Martin Luther wrote in one of his important works, "The Bondage of the Will." But now, since God has taken my salvation out of my hands, of my own will, and has received it into those of his own, and has promised to save me not by my own work or running, but by his own grace and mercy, I'm at ease and certain because he's faithful and will not lie to me, and because he's moreover great and powerful, so that no number of devils, no number of adversities can either wear him out or pluck me out of his hand. Along with Luther, there's John Calvin and Ulrich Zwingli of the Reformers. This was in contrast to the teaching of the Catholic Church that said you need to do something to earn your salvation, to which the Reformers said, well, there's nothing you can do. You need to receive it as a gift. This was the position of John Knox of Scotland, the founder of the Presbyterian Church. This was the position of the Puritans. You'll find this teaching stated in John Owen, in Jonathan Edwards, and George Whitefield. Jonathan Edwards wrote was probably the best regarded treatment of the subject in his work titled Freedom of the Will, published in 1754, in which he summarizes this at one point: the conversion of a sinner being not owing to a man's self-determination, but to God's determination and eternal election, which is absolute and depending on the sovereign will of God and not on the free will of man. There was John Newton, the author of Amazing Grace. We sang his song at the start. Amongst the historical Baptists who held this position were John Bunyan. In his final sermon, John Bunyan wrote, "Believing is the consequence of the new birth, not of blood nor of the will of man, but of God." There was William Carey, one of the first Baptist missionaries. There was Charles Spurgeon, who writes in his autobiography, "I believe the doctrine of election because I am quite certain that if God had not chosen me, I would have never have chosen him. And I'm sure he chose me before I was born, or else he would never have chosen me afterwards. And he must have elected me for reasons unknown to me, for I could never find any reason in myself why he should look upon me with special love." Now, that's in Charles Spurgeon's autobiography. And the next paragraph is too good not to share. He says a man came to him and said, saying, "I've read scripture scores of time and could never find the doctrine of election." The man concluded that if it was in the Bible, he would have found it because he read the Bible on his knees. Spurgeon replied, "Well, I think you read the Bible in a very uncomfortable posture, and if you'd read it in your easy chair, you'd have more likely to understand it." Now, the last 100 years, this perspective was held by men and women, men like Martin Lloyd-Jones, J.O. Packer, and John Stott, and R.C. Sproul. Well, we've been told that there are spiritual blessings for those in Christ. And Paul is eager to tell us of the first blessings, that of being chosen by God. And ideally, Paul tells us about the doctrine of blessing to not start an argument, but so that we would be blessed. And in ways that we are blessed, so in what ways can we say that we're blessed by understanding this work of God in election? Well, the first is that it eliminates boasting. Some of you might think it's the height of arrogance to say, "Well, I'm chosen by God. We're chosen by God, the church." But understanding election should knock the arrogance out of us. It means we know that salvation is utterly of God. He's chosen us not to the praise of our glory, but to the praise of His glory. Imagine if you could get to heaven because of something that you could do, because you were more spiritual, more moral, more intelligent. Then that would be the grounds of your boasting. You could claim some part in your salvation, whether it be small or large. Some of the glory belongs to me. But this doctrine humbles us because we know we don't deserve this. Second, God's choice gives us the assurance of salvation. Suppose it were the other way. If the ultimate grounds of salvation depended on us, I have no doubt in my mind that if it ultimately depended on me, my salvation would be considerably unstable. I might find myself saved one day and lost the next. Now, John Calvin writes, "If our faith were not grounded in God's eternal election, it is certain that Satan might pluck it from us every minute." And Paul gives us great confidence when he writes in Romans, "So then it depends not on human will or exertion, but on God who has mercy." And third, God's choice leads to holiness. And we see that in the passage before us. "Even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him." Being chosen by God doesn't give you a sin as you please card. Do as you like. I'm chosen. It doesn't matter what I do. I can't do anything wrong because God has chosen me. It doesn't matter. You are chosen that you should be holy and blameless. Salvation and holiness, that is obedient living, go hand in hand. And John Stott writes, "Far from encouraging sin, the doctrine of election forbids it and lays up instead the necessity of holiness." God's incredible grace to us should be the cause to want a desire to live for Him in our lives. And the new Holy Spirit, sorry, the Holy Spirit gives us the ability to be obedient. And finally, God's choice leads to evangelism. Men like William Carey encountered, the men that William Carey encountered were dead wrong when they said, well, if God wishes to convert the heathen, he'll do so without you or I. William Carey was a particular Baptist and knew that his Savior commanded Christians to go and preach the gospel, because the gospel is the means that God has appointed to call his people. This is the same motivation that drove Charles Spurgeon to evangelism. Charles Spurgeon deeply loved the doctrine of election, but it didn't keep him from his mission. He said at one point, until God gives me the roll call of the elect, I'm going to preach the whosoever will gospel. Our job is proclamation, not election. We leave election to God and we do our job, which is proclamation. Well, if you've done any theological study, you can probably tell that my convictions on this matter fall in the Reformed camp or the Calvinistic camp, namely that God is sovereign over our salvation. Our faith originates in God, not ourselves. And Paul says, it depends not on human will or exertion, but on God who has mercy. Now, as I said at the start, if you see things differently to me, I appreciate your grace in listening, in considering this perspective, considering how I believe what the Bible says on this matter. And I want to make it clear that if you don't believe, I don't believe that your salvation is contingent on you believing the same things that I believe on this matter. And while it's a vitally important topic, the view you take on election does not ultimately determine your salvation. Your salvation is secured through a simple childlike trust and confidence in Jesus Christ for the glory of God. Let me pray, and we'll pray for the decision that you're going to talk about this afternoon as well. I'll pray for Graham Circum in Lake Nash and our families who are sick as well. Well, Father, we thank you for your word to us today. It reminds us that from beginning to end, salvation is of the Lord. And Father, we thank you for the blessing of election, planned before the foundation of the world to extend grace rather than justice. And Father, at times we do not understand why you would work this way, but you tell us these things so that we wouldn't boast in ourselves, but only boast in you. You tell us that you do it this way for the praise of your glorious grace, and may this doctrine be a point of praise for us. And Father, we read that this call on our lives produces holiness in our lives. So please continue the work that you have commenced in our lives to bring about that fruit of holiness and obedience. Father, help us be faithful to our responsibility of proclaiming the gospel far and wide. And as we do, Father, we pray that you'll be faithful in calling men and women to yourself. And Father, we pray that you would have the joy, that we would have the joy of seeing your Holy Spirit at work, bringing people to life. And Father, we pray that that would be especially true for the people of Lake Nash this morning, as Graham Circum preaches, and as they sit under his teaching of godly relationships and godly marriages. Father, please conform those men and women to your likeness. We pray that this message will be worked in their hearts and minds through your Holy Spirit, and that there would be a wonderful response in the community. We pray for the same for our own community. May the good news of Christ pierce deep into our hearts and the hearts of Mount Isa through the faithful witness of Christians. Be gracious to our many women and children, help them grow to be godly men and women, and help our missionaries persevere in trials. Father, we pray that you would give Ben and Sarah grace and wisdom as they consider the opportunity for Sarah to go back to South Sudan. Father, be with all of our families who are sick this morning. May they recover quickly and trust in you through the trials. Help us be holy and blameless in your sight for the sake of your son, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Good. Thank you, Christy. I'll invite you back.
Please stand and sing with us.
Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. What love could remember no wrongs we have done? Omniscient, all-knowing, He counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. What patience would wait as we constantly roam? What Father so tender is calling us home? He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. What riches of kindness He lavished on us. His blood was the payment, His life was the cost. We stood neath a debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. More. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more.
Thanks for joining us today. There'll be some morning tea served over here, so please hang around and enjoy that, and we'll see you next week.